the linchpin. The older brother is the linchpin. And when he's gone, it's just a terrible shock and loss.
My eldest brother, Jim, died when I was 5. I've been asking a lot of questions. His last couple years were somewhat secretive. I want to get down to every bit of truth that I can get down to. I'd love for my family to have a little more peace on the subject, and I don't think they have peace.
Jim was absolutely different.
Ça c'est mon frère. Il est décédé à Saigon. Hi. Yes.
Hey everybody, I'm Peter McDowell. I am director and producer of Jimmy in Saigon, a documentary film in progress about my eldest brother who died in Vietnam in 1972.
And I'm Dan Savage, executive producer of Jimmy in Saigon, and I do a lot of other things, of course, you may know me for, but I also direct and produce plays and work in television, do some media, and I'm really excited about Jimmy in Saigon and this project that I've been working on with Peter.
We're really thrilled that you could join us this evening. And for the next 90 minutes, you're going to hear from special guest speakers, musical performers, clips from the film. And in the middle of this evening, we're going to have a conversation between me and Dan, moderated by Helen Estabrook. And I'd like to especially thank our sponsors tonight, who are RJ Brooks and George Guerra, as well as Pygmalion Festival, for making it all possible. We do need to raise about $50,000 to finish this documentary, and tonight we hope to raise a big chunk of that.
So we invite you to bid on the auction items to your heart's content, and to check out other ways to support the film at jimmyinsaigon.com. Just click on donate.
So we'll see you a bit later, and for now, on with the show.
Hi, we're Jims, and we're so happy to be a part of Peter's fundraiser to help get this film made.
Wishing he could fly, only to trip at the sound of goodbye. Wordlessly watching, he waits by the window and wonders at the empty place inside. Heartlessly helping himself to her bad dreams, he worries, did he hear any bad or even a hello? They are one person, they are two alone, they are three together, they are four for each other. To tell you, confusion has its cost. Love isn't lying, it's loose in the lady who lingers, saying she is lost.
Hi, my name's Mia Park, longtime and good friends with Peter McDowell, who we are all here to support. Peter, thank you so much for making such an important documentation. Your work is a dedication of love and truly of humanity, which we need now more than ever. And friends watching, there are many ways that you can help Peter finish the documentary. You can donate through his fiscal sponsor. You can Venmo money to Jimmy in Saigon. There's a lot of ways that you can help. But most importantly, thank you for joining Peter on his journey. And I'm honored to be a part of the journey as well. So it's not too late to buy a VIP ticket to the fundraiser. Let's rally and let's donate as much as we can financially and energetically and emotionally to help Peter finish Jimmy in Saigon. Thanks.
Hey there, gang. It's Robbie Faulks here, known as Robbie Faulks in most of the world. And I'd like to thank my friend Peter McDowell for letting me be a part of his virtual fundraiser here and the Pygmalion Festival, of course. And Peter and I met a lot of years back at a place in Chicago called the Cultural Center, where we worked on a lot of offbeat creative projects together over the years. And that's how I come to know him. And now that we both live in the wonderful, though smoky, city of Los Angeles, we've been fortunate to continue to stay in touch. And as I say, I'm happy to be part of this and to help out Jimmy in Saigon, which I've seen just a little bit of, but I know is like a sort of a life passion project for Peter. So he's sort of requested this song, which is about home, which for a lot of us, probably most of us, home is a non-luxurious, non-glamorous place that we can never get rid of. And maybe wouldn't want to. But it's a little bittersweet too. Back in the driveway, the end of the workday, and how fast that world disappeared. Fresh lawn, a pine tree, a neighbor just like me that's worked all his life to get here. A man climbs as high as he can, but his heart belongs where it began. I can see in my mind's eye a shack on a hillside, a mean Billy Goat on a chain, and Dad doing battle, dirt hard as gravel, and summers the crops never came. We'd shoot down a pheasant and sing songs about Jesus all night. And that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes, ma'am, and no, sir. You can't tell I'm country, just you look closer. It's deep in my blood. Cars, a picket fence, that's where I've come. Dirt roads and double wides, that's where I'm from. Night school on a fast track, put a scar on my soul. And I swore my young ones would never know hunger. Now the good life is all they know. Well, I watch them grow, now I see one thing separates them from me, and that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes, ma'am, and no, sir. You can't tell I'm country, just you look closer. White collar, necktie, that's where I've come. Half naked in the moonshine, that's where I'm from. Thing, 'cause that's where I'm from, where time passes slower. That's where I'm from, where it's yes, ma'am, no, sir. You can't tell I'm country, just you look closer. It's deep in my long way down a hard road, that's where I've come. Some place I can't go home to, that's where I'm from.
Hello, my name is Jonathan Ames. My dog just was like, why are you talking suddenly? His name is Fezzik, named after the Andre the Giant character in The Princess Bride. And we're here to, and I, you know, both of us, to support Peter McDowell's wonderful film, Jimmy in Saigon. I want to thank the Pygmalion Film Festival for supporting this film and supporting Peter's work. Last fall, I got a chance to interview Peter about the film in Los Angeles, and anyone who's coming into contact with Peter or this film for the first time, he's utterly passionate about this story, uncovering the truth behind a family mystery and to being set free by the truth. So it's very much a journey, and a beautiful journey, and I hope anyone out there can help him finish making this film and this story of a family overcoming its secrets that haunt it is an important tale, and it's a beautiful family. And just to say goodbye, I'm going to make a sound that my friends and I would make on the playground when being attacked by more normal children, and a kind of also a trumpeting call of support for Peter's endeavor. Oh, excuse me, that's not a COVID cough or a smoke-related cough, though both could be happening here in Los Angeles. But anyway, let's keep making art and help Peter to complete his art.
I'm Helen Estabrook, and I am here with Peter McDowell and Dan Savage, the director-producer of Jimmy in Saigon and the executive producer of Jimmy in Saigon. Thank you guys so much for being here. This is very exciting. So tell me, let's just start, tell me how this all started and the sort of, what was the genesis of this project?
Well, as some people may know who are watching this, I am from Champaign, Urbana. I was born and raised, actually I was born at Carl Hospital in Urbana, and grew up in Champaign, and I ended up going to Uni High, University of Illinois High School, which is where Helen went to school as well, and also my brother Jimmy. I'm the youngest of the family. I was born in 1967, and my oldest brother was 19 years older than me, born in 1948. His name was Jimmy, and he died in Saigon in 1972. So I was born and raised in Champaign, and I had this kind of sense always that something was kind of amiss in my family, and it really had to do with this loss that happened when I was 5 years old. That's pretty much what inspired me to do this. Dan and I first met in 1987. I don't know if you want to talk about that. Tell us where you're from, Dan, just in case people.
I'm from Chicago, Illinois, and I ended up going to the University of Illinois at Champaign-Urbana to attend the Krannert Center for the Performing Arts and the acting program. I wish I could say it was super intentional, but I tried to get into DePaul University, knocked around Chicago for a year, dated some guy who was going to the University of Illinois Champaign-Urbana, and then auditioned for the acting program there and got in and went down there to keep sleeping with that guy. And then we instantly broke up, and then I was marooned in the acting program at University of Illinois in Champaign-Urbana. But I stayed the 4 years. I met Peter there, made a lot of really great lifetime connections there, and I'm glad I went. And it was an interesting place for somebody who grew up inside the city of Chicago in a big city, taking the L when I was a kid by myself, to wind up in all those cornfields with all those Illini.
One famous aspect of my friendship with Dan is that when we met, I actually wrote him a note and put it in his theater mailbox. We were both single, and we ended up dating for 5 years. At that point, it was before dating apps, and it was before cell phones, and it was before the internet, and it was before everything. So I have this famous note that I put in his theater mailbox at the University of Illinois. He thought that I was a crazy axe murderer. Talk about that.
I still have that note. We saw each other in a gay bar, Chester Street, in Champaign-Urbana. And not only was it before the internet, it was before most people our age who were in college were out. Most of the other guys in the theater department, even who were gay, didn't come out till after graduation. So there weren't many of us who were out, and it was very difficult for those of us who were out to connect or find each other. And somebody had to step up and be brave. And Peter was the brave one who wrote the note that I still have.
That's wonderful. Yes, I often refer to Champaign-Urbana as the college town in the cornfields that I grew up in. So it is a very, I think for, it's wonderful coming from Chicago and being a part of all of that. So how did you guys end up working on this project specifically together? Obviously you have a wonderful rich history what was it, Dan, that drew you to telling this story as well?
Well, I met Peter's family, and our families were very different. I was dating Peter for a while before I got to meet his family, even though they're only on the other side of town. It was a different time. And, you know, now the default setting is you expect apps and any other information for families to be supportive and kind of pro having the gay kid. But the default setting then was not the family to be supportive. And it was a very tense Easter brunch I was invited to that I screwed up by dropping an F-bomb within like 5 minutes of sitting down with Peter's very proper parents and siblings. It was as if I pulled a pin on a grenade and rolled it under the table. And it was interesting to meet his family. you could sense that there was a wound there, that there was, you know, and Peter had already told me about his brother. He told me he had a big family and a lot of siblings, and I'm from a big family with a lot of siblings. And he told me that he had an older brother who was deceased, and he shared some of the details of that story with me even then. And you could see, being with his parents, that this was a family where they were all very close and they get together a lot. Everybody kind of, for the most part, stayed in Champaign, and they were all there for each other, but there wasn't the kind of just no holds barred, say anything, processing of pain, you know. And I come from family with, like, you know, the wound was fresh because my parents got divorced shortly before I went away to college. And we would talk about nothing else and process it endlessly and turn it over in late nights of the soul conversations about what it meant and how we were going to get through it. And I could just sense sitting there with Peter's family that they didn't have those conversations about Peter being gay, about Jimmy's death, about other sorts of relationships in the family. And it felt like there was definitely a story there that hadn't been told.
Peter, would you like to set up this first clip that we're going to see of the piece?
Sure. Yeah. As I mentioned, my family all grew up in Champaign-Urbana, and the first 15 minutes of the film or so, by the way, I should say that the film is not completed yet, which is the whole reason we're here tonight, is because we're raising money to finish the film. A lot of people don't know that documentary films are really expensive. Well, I mean, compared to other Hollywood films, they're very inexpensive, but my budget for my film is about $150,000. And I've raised about $100,000 from wonderful, wonderful contributions from people throughout the last few years. But we are raising money to finish it. So what you're seeing right now is segments of a rough cut, and it's actually even prior to a rough cut. So the sound quality, the image, all of that will be corrected when it's the final version. But what you're going to see is, as the film stands now, the first 15 minutes, which is really a setup of Jimmy's life and my family, and you'll see kind of where the first 20 or so years of his life lead. So here's the first 15 minutes of Jimmy in Saigon.
I remember it was summer, I guess it was June.
Well, John and I were in the basement. The doorbell rang.
You know, I remember the man delivering the telegram, and I remember it had Jimmy's name on it. And then we gave the telegram to Daddy.
And he said, "I have some terrible news for you." And he said, "It's Jimmy." And then he said, "He's dead." Dad didn't hug me, I didn't hug Daddy. And we were just like stone.
I think the sense I had was that the warm summer days were gone.
My eldest brother, Jim, died in Saigon on June 6th, 1972, when I was 5. I don't really remember him at all, but I remember that day. I remember what it was like in the house that day. All right.
Hello, hello. This is Peter McDowell. I'm testing my camera.
I don't know much about being a cameraman. And then it's crazy. Oops, sorry for my language. Hi, how does this look?
The reason I really wanted to make this film was because I feel like my brother's death kind of plunged our family into this dark place. There's always been a lot of mystery in my mind. His last couple years were somewhat secretive. There's just so many unanswered questions. I want to get down to every bit of truth that I can get down to, and other people may be resistant.
Are you taking pictures of everybody.
I'm just trying out my equipment because I haven't used it before, so.
Now, is that a camcorder? And a,
yeah, it's a...
And it picks up sound as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, it's an HD digital camcorder.
Gee, you are so technologically up to date here.
This is where I lose a bit of patience with my family because it's 38 years ago and I feel like our family is always sad. There's been this veil of sadness that's been over my family for 38 years.
I feel like really growing up that nobody really wanted to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like they've like kind of forgotten about it
mm-hmm.
or like wanted to forget about it because it hurt everybody so bad.
Mm-hmm.
But lying about it doesn't help anything either.
It makes me kind of angry when I hear people in my family say, you know, oh, it's too sad or it's too raw. And then I think like, well, when is it going to be not raw anymore? Is it going to be 50 years, 100 years, 200 years? How many years is it going to be before it's okay to talk about this?
Maybe talk a little bit about starting your family.
Well, our first child was born on March 14th, 1948. We were new parents with just one child. We just had Jimmy when that picture was taken. Jim was followed by Mary. Mary was born October 4th, 1950. And then Anne arrived, that was in 1953. As fate would have it, I discovered I was pregnant again, and we decided more room was needed. And then in the spring, Jean was born. That was in 1955. And Andy also came home to that house in 1957. Your firstborn remembers you when you were new parents, all those memories that occurred long before the other children came. Jimmy has a little string tie on. He kind of liked little cowboy shirts. Jimmy was bright.
Well, for one thing, he was a big joker.
And he was, you know, kind of the person I felt like that shaped our family sense of humor.
What I remember about Jimmy was that he was someone that the rest of the kids looked up to as a kind of a Pied Piper.
I guess we met in kindergarten. The first time I ever remember talking to him, I asked him what his father did, and he said he played the horn. But I thought that sounded pretty cool. He would entertain the whole class with these stories, so he emerged quite quickly.
And of course, there was the usual amount of like fighting. He and I did have to take ballroom dancing lessons together. I think he hated it. I think that's why it didn't last very long.
I just felt like he was kind of our leader.
I didn't realize it at the time, but I think he really was kind of my father figure and a hero growing up.
I feel like we all looked up to him and thought he was pretty special.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he had this thing about him that I didn't have. Wherever he went, people liked him.
Jimmy was the fastest one of our gang. We used to play tackle football. Jimmy was hard to get down, man. It's like trying to tackle an antelope or something.
He liked to get all the kids together for big games.
I remember we had these neighborhood Olympics that he would put together.
Yeah, he had a clipboard with everybody's name on it. There was like a race around the park. And there was javelin throw. He wrote down everybody's score.
We were so excited about it.
I think Jimmy found it hard to be the eldest of the family. He probably wanted more attention than he got. He didn't particularly like having to share with everyone. There were too many, I think he felt.
I can imagine that the oldest one doesn't have time sometimes for younger activities. So it was kind of a contrast in that he would include us, but he also had sort of a separate existence.
My memories of Jimmy all have to do with being funny. I never knew Jimmy on a heavy level. Among all my friends at Uni, he was the most reserved, reluctant to really reveal much. That's why you do that, because it's something you're hiding from yourself, maybe, and from others, maybe. It was pretty clear even then that he was hurting about things.
I remember, you know, him going off to the University of Chicago, and I remember Mother and Daddy being really happy about that.
We were really proud of him that he was accepted, but it was $4,000 a year tuition, which sounds like nothing now, but at that time it was, you know, break your bank. He was impetuous, and I think he kind of threw himself at school. He loved being in Chicago, but he didn't do well academically.
We lived in the same dorm. Jim spent a lot of nights playing hearts and then sleep until the last possible minute during the day, sometimes beyond.
Like many of us then, he knew a lot of baseball history and followed baseball closely. So we went to some Cubs games.
I understand he never missed a Cub game. There must have been some cutting of school that went along there.
Jim would definitely go off either by himself or with people that were not part of the group that I was. I think he was particular about wanting to keep different parts of his life separate. There was certainly a streak of him that did not want to be a regular student. He was more interested in taking the Illinois Central down to the Loop and going to a double feature at the Clark Theater, which ran a different double feature of vintage films every single day.
And then in 1967, Peter arrived. I remember when I was pregnant with Peter, Jimmy said, "I haven't been to Europe and you're having this baby." He was so interested in the rising tide, the war in Vietnam, what was beginning to happen, what was swelling. And the young people at the University of Chicago were saying things like, "It's not a time to be in college. You know, it's not a time when you should be retreating to academics."
The country is going through a lot of very, very serious problems back then. It's like this cloud of depression settled over the country. But a lot of people had kind of given up on the future.
Obviously, there was an unhappiness about his situation that I don't think he shared, even though he certainly did not want to be drafted. But I think he thought staying in college was just too difficult for whatever reason was going on inside him.
Well, everybody had a draft number. You had to register for the draft. And Jimmy had a very low number. It was like you were under some kind of sword of Damocles that was going to fall down anytime because you were going to get drafted if you didn't watch your step. And so he just decided after his junior year to drop out and get it over with.
I mean, I remember him being home a lot.
Jimmy had been very interested in movie making, and he decided to make a movie with the neighborhood kids, and he recruited them all, and it was just called Archangel Blues.
Of course, it was so exciting.
He kind of had some auditions. He was professional about everything, and I think the neighborhood kids were all very impressed.
My brother John and I were dressed up as gangsters.
I was one of the bank robbers, I guess sort of a starring role.
My sister Ann and her friend were like our gun mauls.
And I was the mother of the gangsters.
We used Jimmy's old car. It was a 49 Plymouth Coupe.
We robbed the sheriff and then jumped into his car and drove away. Of course, I was 13 or something like that. Jimmy was working the accelerator. I was actually steering it.
They put me in the trunk of the car. That's how I traveled in the car, in the trunk.
One of the funnest things was at the end of the movie, there was a pie fight. a real pie fight over at a park in Urbana.
I mean, it was like a big adventure with the whole neighborhood.
It was a real social experiment. I know he was influenced by Fellini, and it wasn't so much slapstick, but it was just kind of bizarre. Bonnie and Clyde meets Dadaism or something like that.
I mean, I remember you know, running around with just a diaper on. You were like a little over a year, I guess. And you picked up one of the cigarettes. And...
Where was this taken here?
Yeah, it's in the next room. This one I found just at Christmas time and kind of blew me away because, yeah. You know, in a way I feel like I was never in his presence, but, you know.
But there's proof you were.
There's the two of us. And this is another one that both of us are in.
Yeah. Look at that. We can count candles and figure out when that was, I guess. Man, look at that.
I've shown this to some people who thought it was kind of...
Uh-oh. Prescient or something.
Yeah. Huh?
The last summer, we would get together at my parents' place and smoke marijuana and listen to the record albums that were popular then. He was disillusioned. Several of our talks were about how he just didn't see any future here in the United States. He thought the country was going to hell and that it was in the hands of military fanatics. And the images we saw on the evening news every night, I mean, the war was in your living room.
And of course, then it wasn't long until he was drafted.
I remember that he wanted to be a conscientious objector, and I know there was a lot of tension and anxiety about that.
I guess I felt in some ways we were kind of losing him.
I told him that it wouldn't bother me if he went to Canada. It was a huge conflict, huge, in our family. Very unhappy years.
We were all good kids, and we all were patriots, and we, you know, we would have died for our country and all that stuff. We only wanted to know why. Nothing made any sense in those days. You could try and address things logically, or you could try and, you know, work for the future. You could be a good kid and stay in school or whatever. But none of it made any sense, because ultimately there were people who were sending you off to be killed, and they wouldn't even tell you why.
So you can see the family I'm talking about sort of stumbling into is a loud, profane Chicago Catholic. But Peter, this story has sort of rattled around in your family, or feels like it's needed to have been told and addressed for so long. What inspired you to make this film now and start to work on this story and tell this story and unpack this family mystery?
I mean, I think much in the same way that, you know, when I came out when I was 17 years old, and a lot of people say, you know, how did you manage to come out so early? I mean, nowadays it doesn't seem so early, but back then it was very early. And I just said, it's just welled up inside me, and I couldn't not do it. I had to do it. And in the same way, this film had been percolating in me for a while. When I was a grad student at University of Wisconsin in Madison, I studied arts management, but I took an elective course in film, and it was really, I really took to it. I really enjoyed it. My brother Jimmy actually had been a filmmaker as well, kind of just amateur films, and I think we saw part of an amateur film that he made in this clip. But I was inspired to take a film class, and I did some cute little projects, including some that Dan helped me on, and which can still be seen somewhere on the web probably. But they were very short films, like experimental Super 8 films. And
they're on Pornhub.
Yes.
No.
But at any rate, you know, I moved to San Francisco after that, and my friends, I showed one of these short films to my friends, and they said, this is really good. You should submit it to a festival. So I submitted this film that I made called I Dream of Dorothy, which was just a little just a funny little fable about a gay kid. I submitted this to film festivals and it got into film festivals. And I really explored the idea of becoming a filmmaker as a profession then. And it just seemed overwhelming to me going to film school. And at that point, I really liked the way film looked, but I didn't like the way video looked because video in the 90s didn't look very good. Dan had told me, you know, that he thought that this would make a good idea for a film, the story of my brother and my family. So I kind of stored that away in the back of my head. And then in 2010, which is exactly 10 years ago, I was in a new phase of my life. I was in Brooklyn. I had been in a job that was eliminated due to the economic crisis. And I was a freelancer. I was working from home. And all of a sudden, this flooded back into my head. And I thought, I have the time and the energy to make this film now. But it is almost 40 years. It was almost 40 years after his death at that point. And now it's almost 50 years after his death. So I thought maybe it was too late to do the film. And I approached a lot of filmmakers that I knew, and I approached a lot of friends, and I got a unanimous response that everybody said, this is interesting, you should do it. And I started out trying to interview everybody that my brother ever knew. So it was really, it has been a labor of love since the beginning. And you know, as I said, it kind of welled up inside of me.
Has it changed? Has the process, as you've been going through this process, has your family's response to talking about it changed? Have they opened up a bit? Has it been, have you noticed a sort of, as you're going through, the differences in what people are able to speak about?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, one of the first like cuts of this film, or even little segments of it, I talk about how frustrated I am that my family doesn't want to talk about this. And they, you know, it's still a little bit of an issue, as Dan says. It's like, I have a wonderful family and I love them, but talking about things is hard for us. But I would say over the years, people have definitely warmed up, and my sisters and brothers have, you know, not only warmed up to it, but they've also helped me in various ways. I mean, you need your family's help for this kind of thing. I needed to get access to all those images and all those video, all those super, you know, 8mm films, and my dear mother, who is now 96 years old, is tireless in her ability to sit in front of the camera and answer questions for me, which is really lovely. And it's really hard. It's really hard because she cries almost every time I interview her, and she really kind of breaks down. And it pains me that I have to make her go through that. And every time I do it, I say, it's the last time I'm interviewing her. But there's a tiny bit of me that hopes that it brings some release. But, you know, I've asked my mom, is this helpful to you? Does this bring you release? And she says, honestly, no. So, I mean, that's her honest response.
It's really interesting to see the video, the interviews with your siblings and mom, now having known your family intimately for 5 years, 25, 30 years ago, because there's at once this difference in seeing everyone kind of open up. You know, it wasn't like the fact that Jimmy had lived and died was a secret. It just wasn't ever discussed. Like, the fact of your homosexuality was known, but there was no acknowledgement. And I do remember some conflict with your mother back in the day, where she thought you were saying things to her that I had coached you to say or encouraged you to say. And it's just interesting to see now your family opening up this way, but there's still this through line of not resentment, but resistance. It's probably better to talk about these things, but they would still rather not directly address them or look into the sun. It's like looking at the sun, looking directly at the sun. It's gonna hurt to do it, but eventually, in this case, Jimmy's death is a sun that must be stared at, must be looked at directly, and maybe for the first time.
I mean, I have a remove that my brothers and sisters don't have, because I don't really remember him. And for them, he was like a hero, and he was like a second father. So, because my dad was, you know, was a dad of six children, and he worked really hard, and he went to the office, and he was exhausted when he got home. And so Jimmy was sort of this sort of substitute father figure. So I think that that also made it much harder. Another thing I wanted to mention is that, you know, I wouldn't say every day, but like practically every week, I talk to somebody about this film, and they say, I lost a brother, or I lost a sister, or I lost somebody. And that has really inspired me, as well as the fact that it doesn't feel like I'm only talking about me, or I'm only talking about my family, but I'm also talking, it could be any family.
Yeah, I'm sure that this is something that a lot of people can relate to, both the tragic experience, but also the way in which people can and can't talk about things is obviously quite a universal thing. Would you like to show us the next clip and tell us about that?
Yeah, so basically what happened was, you know, I got this equipment and I set out to try to meet everybody, whoever knew my brother. And I really wanted to go to Vietnam right away. That was like my goal. But I naively didn't realize that that would take a lot of preparation and money and planning to go to Vietnam. So I basically started out in the United States, and I traveled to see as many people as I could. And I also went to France to visit a French journalist who was a good friend of my brother's. And I also encountered some barriers, some boundaries that I never thought I would have, which is that I found more than one, in fact, several people who were really good friends of my brother's who either flat out refused to participate in the film, or, you know, said that they would participate and then backed out. So that's been kind of an interesting conflict that we will see that kind of worked out in the film. But in the next clip, we'll see a little bit of the beginnings of my traveling around and meeting people.
Are you nervous, Peter?
No, not me. I'm never nervous.
It's okay to be nervous.
I'm a little bit nervous. A lot of what drew us together was being funny. Jimmy was sort of the dry wit of the group.
He would entertain the whole class with these stories.
Jim got drafted. We all got together and we talked about it, and we decided that he had to stay straight, you know, that he was going to, by God, come home alive. Jim never used any drug before he went to Vietnam except marijuana. I know that for certain. 2 weeks later, I got a letter from him saying, send me anything, uppers, some downers, some mescaline, some acid, anything, you know. I was like, what happened? I mean, Vietnam happened. And then he came back, it was as if his eyes were here and the real Jim was a foot back further inside his head, like he was removed from reality. He said he was concerned for the Vietnamese people. I mean, it was just like, I got to get back to my family kind of thing. He'd been living with the family, you know, off base sometimes. We thought that he had fallen in love with some woman over there and wouldn't tell us about her, because that's the way he acted.
I was the one who opened the telegram. It was from the U.S. Army. I said, we regret to inform you that your son has died from a heroin overdose. I think generally the message was that we didn't believe it was true.
You know, when I was growing up, my parents didn't mention anything at all about drugs, and they said that he died of a tropical disease. And I thought, well, this is confusing. And so
this is the telegram that my parents got. I brought a copy of that.
The telegram says from septicemia caused by heroin. That, mm-hmm. You know, that isn't accurate. I mean, mm-hmm. It was septicemia caused by a boil.
Mm-hmm. And you said in the letter to my parents, I saw many tragedies in Vietnam, and Jim's death was one of the worst. Why do you think?
Tragic, because it's preventable. Mm-hmm. You know, if he'd been in the day before, we would have saved him. Mm-hmm. I know we would have.
So this is the book. It's a book my mom put together. There's a whole bunch of letters from Jim. There's a signature. Basically, she has all of his letters on Vietnam. These are letters from Lu Yan, from the Vietnamese girl that he lived with. So that's the address that he lived at also the name of the brother, Tran Khan Dong.
You know, those of us who were gay and came out young in the 70s and 80s, we were the secret. We were the family secret. Even if our families acknowledged our gayness, they didn't talk about it with others, and they weren't even comfortable talking about it with us. And so when Peter and I went to that first Easter brunch that I was invited to, where I dropped the F-bomb, I think all gay kids are really finally sort of really consciously aware of like secrets lurking and what's behind, because we were secrets. And, you know, to protect our own secret before we came out to our family, took a lot of sort of emotional intelligence and deftness, and just walking in to sit with Peter's family, who I really enjoyed and liked, particularly sister Anne and brother-in-law Henry, really appreciated them. I could, as that sort of like wired to sense like there's a secret here, there's something that people don't want to talk about, and usually it's us, even if we're out and they will, it can accept it. Just being there, there was just this oppressive sense that there was this other thing that hadn't been addressed, and not quite a secret. Like the fact of Jimmy's death was acknowledged, and but there was more that wasn't being examined, shared, unpacked. And I think as the gay kids sitting there, the both of us, Peter and I at the time, didn't feel like kids then. Certainly in retrospect, we were kids. We could sense it.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that one of my major motivations to get back to that conversation is it was kind of like, come on, guys, like, let's talk about this. And I think that I've been the squeaky wheel in the family to say, like, this is not okay for us not to talk about this. And, you know, there was a very beautiful family meeting that we had where my, you know, my oldest sister, Mary, was only a few years younger than Jimmy. And then the next boy, John, was quite a bit younger. I mean, he's older than me. And there was one point where Mary said, you know, she said, after Jimmy's died, you know, John seems like he's the oldest in the family, but I really am. Like, I'm the oldest person left. And, you know, and I think that there are family dynamics that never got discussed like that. Like, and, you know, Mary remembers him her whole life. So this is very affecting to her. And Jimmy was 2 years old when she was born, you know, so.
And, you know, part of it, I think, that I responded to in like being with Peter's family and seeing how Jimmy's death was sort of emotionally set was that there was this sense, and we will have seen this in the clips, that there was something shameful about Jimmy's death. And I identified with Jimmy at times, even though, of course, I never knew him and I've only seen a couple of photos, because in the same way there was something shameful about his death, there was something shameful about our existences, which created a kind of, you know, across time bond, weirdly, that I could sense between Peter and Jimmy, that there was this shame about Jimmy, about the way he, you know, what the telegram said about how he passed away, but also the shame about Peter and who he was.
Yeah, that's very true. And also Jimmy and I are the only two members of our family to go to uni high. And, you know, we
felt very shameful.
It's very shameful, very shameful. And, you know, shameless nerds. But I would say we had academic interests. We had certain interests that we, even though we didn't know each other, we certainly were interested in film and academics. And even though at University of Chicago, he didn't do well and he dropped out. And that's one thing that I've been exploring a lot is like, how could that happen? How could he not do well at University of Chicago and drop out? Well, he was there from 65 to 68. And all the research I've been doing is that that was a crazy time at every university on in the United States, kids did not want to be in school. They wanted to be out in the streets protesting, and they didn't believe in these institutions. So it all completely makes sense to me now.
It's interesting that you were the only two who to go to Uni High, because obviously as someone who also went to Uni High, I think it is such a specific and wonderful, but interestingly unique experience. So I can imagine even that connection, starting this whole sort of conversation from that connection that you guys were the only ones in the family to have. And it's a really interesting thing to share with someone. Well, one of the reasons that I'm here is because we, all three of us, are producers. I only work in narrative, so I am very curious. It's funny, producing is one of those things that it means so many different things to so many different people, and the titles change. And I was even explaining to somebody the other day that in television, executive producer is sort of the highest level, and film producer is sort of the highest level for narrative, because that's for awards things. It's all very confusing. So I'm curious, because I haven't ever worked in documentaries. What does it mean to be the executive producer of a documentary, Dan?
Sometimes I get involved as a producer with a project because I want to see it. I worked really hard on this thing that didn't end up going, which 90% of everything doesn't end up happening, which is extremely frustrating. I worked on this thing for years called Caroline Matilda because I wanted to watch it. And I think that often is what makes someone a good producer, or makes what they produce good, is that they're creating the content on some level to satisfy something in themselves as a viewer, something that they, as a media consumer, that they want to watch. And I've wanted to watch this documentary about Peter's brother and about Peter's family since I met them. And the wealth of family films capturing that time, just what was in the first clip, is so compelling that I can't, in a way, I'm involved as a producer because I can't wait to see the finished product.
Well, thanks. That's very nice to hear. I thought of myself as the director because it was my idea to do this. And then I remember talking to people and saying, how can I be a director if I haven't directed a feature length documentary before? But basically what I realized and what I learned is that I needed to find a really wonderful editor, and an editor who is what they call an auteur editor, so an editor who could really help put the story together with me. So I found our editor, Kelly Creedon, who is fantastic, and she's working on The Rough Cut right now. She's located in North Carolina, and I've never met her in person. We hired her in February, and she started working in March, and I like to say that that I'm very lucky that this film coincided, the way that this film coincided with the pandemic is sort of amazing, because we just started editing at the moment that the pandemic set in, and editing is by nature social distancing. It's like you sit in a dark room and edit. So that's what's been happening since March, other than also we've done a few more interviews. I did my first Zoom interview. The director part is just, it's my vision and it's what I want to move forward. In terms of me producing, I have raised all the money for this project and, managed the staff and all that. So those are the two skills that I'm honing. They're not skills that I've had in my regular career. I've been working in arts management, so I've been working in the administration of performing arts, but I've also produced a lot of live, a ton of live things on stage, opera, theater, concerts for my whole career. So I'm just sort of morphing the live performance aspect into the media arts. And I'm interested in narrative as well. And that's something that I'm exploring, looking at in the future. I'm also interested in making more documentaries. And I have said this publicly, and I'll say it again, that people say, if you were going to make another documentary, what would you make it about? And I say, right now, I would make a documentary about the band The Roaches. I don't know if you guys know The Roaches. but a lot of people don't. But it's a group of three sisters, R-O-C-H-E-S, and I love them, and I think a documentary should be made about them. But I can't think about anything until this one gets done, and this one's not going to get done until we were hoping to finish it this fall, but we decided to take our time with the pandemic, and we're going to get it done in early 2021.
I mean, you're certainly, Helen, a much more experienced producer than either of us. But in my far more limited experience, they're the producers who are the detail people who make sure everything happens when it needs to happen and chase everything down. And then they're the producers who are sort of just dreamy and wouldn't it be neat if we could blow this up? Peter is more detail and at once, however, you know, framing this and directing it and starring in it and shaping it. But Peter is much more the detail-oriented, organized person and always has been throughout the time I've known him, which is most of our lives at this point, or the majority of our lives.
Yes, but I love that. I love what you were saying about producing as sort of just wanting to see the thing exist and wanting to watch it. It's something that I talk about a lot and about for projects that I'm working on or take on. A lot of it has to do with like, what do I want to watch? What do I want to exist in the world that would make me happy to be around? So it's wonderful to hear both of you talk about it. And obviously then yes, the aspect of producing that is just raising the money, getting it done, doing all of the nitty gritty as well. So that's really exciting. What is
I've never had a checkbook, much less balanced a checkbook. I wouldn't even know how to do that part of it. I'm an idiot.
So what is next for this project as far as like what next steps do you have?
You know, we are about maybe halfway through with our rough cut. We're hoping to be done with the rough cut by October or November. It's going to be probably longer than the actual film, so we'll have to go through that, decide what we want to keep. We will be involving animation, so we just engaged someone for animation. There's a lot of kind of nuanced aspects of the story that are not visible, that can't be shown either through interviews or home movies, and so we're going to involve some animation. There's a soundtrack that my brother John is writing, so I have four surviving siblings, and John McDowell, my brother, is an experienced film composer. He actually wrote the score for an Academy Award-winning documentary called Born into Brothels from 2004. So he's going to be working on the score. We'll be maybe doing a few more interviews. I'm not going back to Vietnam, at least not to film. I will definitely go back as a tourist because it's such a wonderful place. Which kind of leads us to the next clip, which is basically, before I go into that, I will say that obviously to demystify this project for those who don't know about the process of putting together a documentary, once I finish financing the film and raising the money, which I'm doing tonight, and I am also open to more producers if anyone wants to come on as a producer, I still have slots available for that. But
polyamorous where producers are concerned.
Yes, for sure, definitely. When one gets the film finished, then one submits to festivals. And the old model is you submit to these festivals and then you spend a whole year traveling around to festivals. Now, is that going to happen in the future? I don't know. Are festivals going to happen in person? We decided not to do this festival season, which would be basically starting in January. Sort of fingers crossed that maybe next festival season will be in person, but we'll be submitting to festivals and then distribution deals either come before or after or during festivals. And, I have high ambitions for this film, but I'm also like, I'm sure it will land where it's supposed to land. So I'm just seeing what happens with that.
And I think it's a very specific story, but I think it will land with a lot of people. Families are always temporary. Families come together and time and event pulls them all apart. And sometimes it's just, you know, the natural course of time and events and kids growing up and moving away. But sometimes there's an explosion begin the process of a family falling apart. There's nothing shameful in a family coming apart. All families come apart. All families are temporary. And this is, Jimmy's death is really the bomb that like creates these fissures in this particular family. In the same way in my family, it was my parents' very unexpected divorce. In some families, it's just, you know, time. But all families can point to that moment where something happened that irrevocably changed the family in a way that was permanent and, you know, not a scarring, you know, we're all scarred, covered in scars, but something happens, something, an event, an explosion happens in every family that doesn't, and I'm regretting myself to ground here, but you know what I mean. Like there's something universal about even this specific story, even about a death in a family 50 years ago that I think everyone's going to relate to.
Absolutely, that I resonate with all of that. And as time goes on, most, you know, all families are affected. And you know, I experienced death in my family at a very young age, but now I'm at an age where people, a lot of my friends are starting to experience death. And
I mean, it's such an obvious, it's obviously such an intimate story for you. Have you been surprised now that you're working with your editor on things that have come out or things that maybe your editor has seen or is pulling out that you weren't thinking of? Or have there been sort of surprises in this part of the process for you?
Yeah, I mean, I think that was my hope, really, because I was talking to Dan earlier today about the fact that I hate watching myself on film and video. And so I'm kind of in this weird situation where I made this film and yet I don't want to watch. I love watching what my editor has put together, but I don't really love watching raw footage. And I force myself to do it. But basically what she luxuriates and enjoys and what I hired her to do is to like dig into that footage and find stuff that I probably wouldn't find. And that's exactly the kind of editor that I wanted. And it's what she's delivering. So I think there will be surprises to me. There will be moments that I didn't expect, for sure.
You can already see the impact Kelly's had on the film. That's why editors get their own Academy Awards. That is a huge role and is really helping to tell the story.
Absolutely, and she just got Emmy nominated as well. That happened, I believe, last month. So we're really fortunate to have her. I guess I'll introduce this last segment, which is just a few minutes, and it sort of introduces you to the idea, or to me going to Vietnam for the first time. I ended up traveling to Vietnam twice for this film, and you'll see some of that in this clip. And I was curious as to whether my brother loved the country. He was, I should mention that he was in the army, which we haven't really talked about too much in this conversation. He was in the army, went to Vietnam, was a clerk, so he didn't see combat, but you know, he was still at a base that probably had a lot of explosions happening around it. But he was a clerk, finished his tour of duty in the army, spent a lot of time in Saigon, and then came back to the United States and then returned to Vietnam as a civilian. So that was very unusual at the time. And one of the questions, one of the big questions of this film is why would someone return to a war zone in the middle of the war as a civilian? And people ask me that question and I say, you have to watch the film to find out. So this next clip is my visit, a little bit of my visit to Vietnam, to Saigon.
I really have to go to Vietnam. I still have the address of the house that he lived in. I have all the addresses of all the places that he went. There's so much I think I could discover over there.
Ask you a question. I'm looking for a place in Saigon, and I can't find it. Ça c'est mon frère. Il est décédé à Saigon.
in yet?
I don't know who these people are, but somebody in her family.
I got to see the neighborhood where Jim lived with Luin and Song. I mean, right now we're on a rooftop in Saigon, and I think I should point out that that's important because he talked about that in his letters, where he said that he would go up to a rooftop with his friends and drink red wine and watch the bombs explode, and it looked like fireworks in the sky to watch the bombs explode.
Ever since I was a little kid, my family always told me to be careful all the time. And I grew up being very afraid of everything. When I was in my 20s, I said to my family, don't say be careful anymore. The phrase we came up with was live on the edge. So I decided now that I'm in Saigon, that's what I'm doing. I'm riding on the back of an Uber motorcycle, living on the edge.
So one of the other things that the three of us have in common, besides all being producers, is that we all have spent some significant time in Champaign-Urbana. So tell me, guys, about your time there. Obviously, you know, Peter, you grew up there and went to school there. Dan, you went to school there. Tell me everything about Champaign.
It's a great bike town because it's perfectly flat. Like, they made it with a level. I really loved it. It was so far outside my experience because I was an urban kid. To be in a small town, but also what felt like a very rural place, and then to be able to get out into other rural parts of the state, it appealed to my sense of kitsch because there was just, we were just awash in it then in that place. But I loved the U of I, the student union. I waited tables at the Courier Cafe for years to help put myself through school. That was back when you could wait tables and put yourself through school, which isn't possible anymore. And we need to make that possible again by paying waiters more or making school cheaper or both. And it was a great time. And I made this connection with Peter, and it's been a lifelong connection.
Dan was in a lot of shows at Krannert. And there was one time when I was in an opera and he was in a play at the same time. And so we would meet backstage in our ridiculous costumes. I definitely have a photo of that somewhere.
And make out.
But yes, Dan and I have been good friends. You know, we were together for about 5 years and then we've been good friends ever since. And I'm good friends with his partner, and I know his kid and all that.
We had really amazing life experiences. It was because of Peter that I ended up being in Berlin when the wall fell. We traveled all over Eastern Europe together. Peter and I actually were snuck into the Kremlin during the very final party conference before the Soviet Union dissolved. It was closed to tourists, but somehow our Russian host, whose apartment we were staying in on the outskirts of Moscow, bribed a guard or something and got us in. And we were walking around amidst the generals in the closed Kremlin. They were very interesting times. Traveled in Poland and Egypt. In a way and at a time that it doesn't feel possible anymore. And we were out the whole time in the very, you know, in the 80s. We were out as a gay couple in Egypt, which was probably risky then and would be suicidal now. We were crazy. We found two other couples we met on while we were touring around Egypt, and booked a felucca, I can't remember the name of that boat, with these two other couples, hired a private boat on New Year's Eve to float us down the Nile from Aswan to Luxor or something. And we, you know, there were two Egyptian guys who were piloting this boat and making the meals. And we were like, oh, by the way, we're a couple, so brace yourselves, we're gonna kiss on New Year's Eve. I don't know what we were thinking. We felt very alive at that time. Everything felt, it just, to be gay then, you know, in the face of the HIV/AIDS epidemic and everything else going on in the world, you just felt like might as well live your life because you don't know how much of it you're going to have. And Peter and I lived like that for that time. And it was wonderful.
As he said, we were in Berlin when the wall came down, and then we happened to decide to go to Prague on a whim. And we happened to be in Prague during the entire Velvet Revolution. And we were in Wenceslas Square when the snow was coming down and people were holding candles and singing the national anthem in unity while Václav Havel was speaking, and artists were hand silk screening posters that they were putting up over around town, which I always tell people that this contrasts greatly with the fall of the Berlin Wall, which was mostly about drunkenness and people buying bananas. So
tell us how people who want to support this film can help.
Well, number one, you can go to jimmyinsaigon.com. That's jimmyinsaigon.com. And there's a donate button there. All donations are tax deductible. And we also have an auction going on right now where you can bid on items and support the film through that. So those are two great ways to support.
Well, thank you both so much for being here. This has been really fascinating, and I'm very excited to see this final film. Thank you to Peter and Dan for your time, and thanks again.
Thank you, Helen. Thank you
so
much.
Thanks, Helen.
Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear a word they're saying. Only echoes of my mind. People stop and staring. I don't see. Skipping over the
Hi, I'm John McDowell, Jimmy's younger brother. I'm here with my daughter, Luna. We were here to support Peter's wonderful new film, Jimmy in Saigon. It needs to be finished and the story needs to be told. So please be generous tonight. We'd like to also thank Pygmalion for really going all the way and making this happen.
Hi, my name is George Guerra. R.J. Brooks and I decided to donate to Jimmy in Saigon because we viewed this project as a labor of love, the love of two brothers and the search for the truth. This could be applicable to so many of our lives and our families today. So we ask you to please join us in supporting Jimmy in Saigon. Thanks for all your help and support.
The story of Jimmy in Saigon is compelling. It's like a lifelong quest, and it has to be completed. So anything I can do, it gives me a pleasure to be a part of it.
Like all good narratives, Peter's story is very personal. And yet its theme, the loss at a young age of someone truly loved yet hardly known, is universal. That's why I support this documentary. I hope you'll join me.
So welcome. We are Acoustic Eidolon, and we are thrilled to be part of this virtual fundraiser to help Peter raise money for this film for Jimmy in Saigon. Peter and I go way back in life. We go all the way back to kindergarten and, I don't know, possibly before. But we went to Southside School together in Champaign, Illinois, with a whole lot of other people who have gone on to do amazing things in their lives as well. And here we are reconnecting for this project and this amazing undertaking that Peter has done. So we'd like to play a piece to help with this fundraiser. This is one that Peter had requested because, I guess, Jimmy just loved the Beatles. And so we'd like to do a Beatles tune. We'd like to do their Eleanor Rigby and Jimmy. This one's for you. Thank you. Thanks for listening. Good luck with the film, Peter, and keep on keeping on.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. I would like to give a big shout out to our musical guests, Gems, Robbie Folks, Nora O'Connor, Acoustic Eidolon, and John and Luna McDowell. And also a big thanks to Dan Savage, Helen Estabrook, Jonathan Ames, Mia Park, and to the Pygmalion Festival. We're Jimmy in Saigon, and that's jimmyinsaigon.com. Take care.
Once came across a blind dinosaur. We foresaw what went and came before us.
Do you even think he saw us?
But like Taurus, I'm relentlessly pacing, chasing a deeper view. Socially conditioned, positioned without a right to choose.
Right to choose.
If I had a